Last year, the Associated Press sent out this headline. Now, I was working in a newspaper's office that week. I know, newspapers still exist. It's weird. And so everyone around me was pretty much plugged directly into Twitter. And the reaction was astonishing. Flight 17 had gone down only a week earlier. The idea that another plane, one carrying bodies from that disaster, could also have crashed, it seemed unreal. And it was, because what the Associated Press actually meant was Dutch military plane, comma, carrying bodies from Malaysia Airlines Flight 17 crash, comma, lands in Eindhoven. Now, there were many problems with that message, not least the fact that a plane landing uneventfully is not breaking news, but it's also a great example of how ambiguous English can be. The result is called a crash blossom, after this particularly ambiguous headline from a few years ago. Ambiguity is when you have a word or sentence that can mean two different things. All languages, except for some incredibly pedantic constructed ones, have ambiguity. Now, we'll set aside for a moment pragmatic ambiguity, which is when you raise your hand in class and say, "Oh, can I go to the toilet?" And some smart-ass of a teacher replies, "Oh, I don't know, can you?" Leaving that aside, English has scopal, lexical, and structural ambiguity. Scopal ambiguity is when you have two or more quantifiers in a sentence, and the order in which they're applied isn't clear. "Everybody loves somebody" is the canonical example. It can mean that for every person, there is someone that they love. Or it can mean that there's a single somebody that's loved by everyone. It's like the old joke. In the UK, a woman gives birth every 30 seconds. She must be exhausted. Lexical ambiguity is when you've got a word that can mean multiple things. You might have heard the famous sentence, "Buffalo, buffalo, 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 buffalo." But my favourite one is from the opening chapters of The Hitchhiker's Guide to the Galaxy, where hyperspace travel is described as unpleasantly like being drunk. What's so wrong about being drunk? You ask a glass of water. Mind you, that's not just lexical. That change in meaning also changes the structure of the sentence. And that's the most interesting kind of ambiguity, structural ambiguity, which is what we started with. Let's have a look at that crash blossom sentence. JAL is Japan Airlines, by the way, but let's take that out to make the sentence a bit simpler. Okay. Let's diagram this sentence. If you're American, you might actually have been taught how to do this in school for some bizarre reason. This shows you how it was intended. And presumably the headline writer, having come up with it, didn't see it any other way. Most readers, though, saw this. Why? Well, there are eye-tracking studies, watching how people read and reread a sentence, that show we build the interpretation of a sentence in our head as we read it. As we scan left to right, in English anyway, as we scan left to right, our brain tries to assemble concepts out of the words it's seeing. So, violinist, linked to crash, yeah, okay, what's the next word? If it were recovers, then that's clearly a verb. It must apply to the violinist, so our brain settles on that one really quickly. If it were sight, then that's clearly a noun. Must be part of the noun phrase crash sight. Our brain settles on that quickly. Blossoms, though. That can be a verb, sure. But it can also be a noun. There's no clear link, and heck, it's physically closer to crash than violinist. So most people, it seems, come up with crash blossoms, and then they go, wait, what? And that brings us to these wonderful constructions called garden path sentences. They're called that because they lead you up the garden path. They trick you. They send you down a false trail. Garden path sentences solve the question of whether we take a whole sentence into memory before trying to comprehend it, or whether we build this structure as we go along. We must do it piece by piece. If you waited to see the whole thing before working it out as a big block, then you wouldn't get confused. Now, for more complicated garden path sentences, like this lovely one, go ahead, take a second, I will spoil it with intonation if I actually read that out loud. Eye-tracking studies mean we can watch people jump back to earlier points in the sentence and scan around, while their brain tries to work out what it's been shown. Generally, ambiguity is something to be avoided in everyday conversation. It's the foundation of countless jokes and occasionally legal loopholes, but if you're just trying to be understood, well, it's probably not going to help you out. But linguists can love ambiguity more than most people. More than most people. More than most people. More.